Just want to conclude with a comment about the future, which I'll illustrate with a comment about the past. Since 2003, as I say, I've seen a number of occasions on which Iraq has started to move in a more positive direction, away from sectarianism, away from bloodshed, away from corruption. In 2003, for instance, there was the formation of trade unions, and the US reacted by saying trade unions are illegal. In 2004, a genuine national movement that asserted the common religious identity of Iraqis between Shia and Sunni, and they said, we're one Iraqi people, we don't care about the Shia Sunni thing. That really started to dominate public discourse, this assertion of unity. And the commanding US general in Iraq at the time, a guy called General Ricardo Sanchez, he said, we're noticing linkages between the Shia and the Sunni, we need to stop this. And in 2007, following the struggle over the oil law, a number of Iraqi politicians started to set up a non-sectarian coalition. Politics was dominated by sectarian parties. And the US sent a number of officials to Iraq and said, those people are in the government, you keep quiet. And the people who were in the government were the USA's allies, who were the most corrupt and sectarian of the parties. And then in 2008 and 2009, also following the results on the oil law, Iraqi politics started to move in a much more Iraqi direction and rejecting sectarianism. And in 2009, there were some provincial elections. And in those provincial elections, the parties that succeeded were the ones that were least sectarian in the way they talked. And the ones that identified themselves as Shia parties and Sunni parties, they were trounced in the election. And following that election, these parties started to step across the sectarian boundary, Shia parties organizing together with Sunni parties and setting up cross-sectarian coalitions and so on. And there were national elections coming up in 2010. And the US ambassador at the time, appointed by President Obama, he was a guy named Christopher Hill, he went to the Iraqi politicians, he used all of the diplomats in the embassy to go to Iraqi politicians and say, no. You are Shia, you represent the Shia. You are Sunni, you represent the Sunni. He drove them back apart. And the situation in Iraq, so the 2010 election came and went, and Iraqi politics, you know, sectarianism became very significant, central within it again. It then, after the election, Iraq achieved a world record, actually, for the greatest amount of time between an election and the formation of a government. And the reason was, all of these corrupt and sectarian politicians, they just spent their time haggling over which of them would get which budgets and which armed forces and blah blah blah. It took them 9 months to form a government. They eventually formed a government in December 2010, and the reason they formed it was not because they'd suddenly found some kind of political maturity. It was because the Iraqi Supreme Court forced them to do so. It ordered them to either form a government or to hold another election. The reason it did was four Iraqi civil society organizations have taken a case to the Supreme Court to force the politicians to form a government. Well, with these kind of characters who are really only, as the International Crisis Group puts it, they consider the ministry, they treat the ministries as private bank accounts. And with this kind of government in place, Iraqis, it's perhaps not surprising that Iraqis still only get about 3 hours of electricity a day. And we've had it's been a heat wave here in the USA. It's been pretty uncomfortable. Some of the time I've been traveling around, and some of the days I've been around here, the temperature's gone about 100 degrees. And I've said to myself, thank God for air conditioning. In Basra, the temperature in the summer and in Baghdad commonly reaches 130 degrees. And with getting electricity only 3 hours a day, I don't have air conditioning. And this is what the current government is doing for them. Meanwhile, the Maliki government, since the contracts that were signed, saw what the trade unions achieved on the oil law and got some trouble with their oil contracts here, they've escalated repression against trade unions. They've raided their offices, seized their computers, smashed up their furniture, arrested their leaders, prosecuted their leaders, cut the wages of anyone active in trade unions. And so where we are today, where things are headed for the future, I think it's very uncertain, in fact. Iraqi politics looks more fluid to me today than it has for a number of years. I don't feel able to predict what Iraqi politics will look like in 12 or even in 6 months' time. I don't even feel able to predict whether Nouri al-Maliki will still be the Iraqi Prime Minister. And the reason is that I think there are three different directions Iraqi politics could go in. You know, the first direction is we could see a reversion to dictatorship. You know, he's carrying out, under Nouri al-Maliki, he's carrying out these attacks on trade unions and on civil society, using many of the same tools that were used by Saddam Hussein. That's the first scenario. Then there's a second scenario, which is in this political vacuum that's being created, where there's a government which is sectarian, which doesn't serve the interests of people. Well, Iraq might revert to the sectarian bloodshed of a few years ago, remember in 2006-2007. And as David said, you know, yesterday was the bloodiest day in Iraq for a number of years, and in fact these last few weeks have seen an escalation in violence. And so that's the second possibility. It might be a reversion to sectarian conflict. But there's a third possibility, and the third possibility is that Iraq might start to develop into something that more genuinely represents a democracy. As I've said, I look at the period since 2003, and there are a number of occasions where Iraqi civil society has started to move the country in a much more positive direction, in the direction of democracy, in the direction of peace, challenging corruption in the oil contracts, and so on. And unfortunately, almost every time they've done that, it's been the USA which has dragged Iraq back into the terrible situation of sectarianism and corruption. But US troops were forced to be withdrawn from Iraq at the end of last year. They left. The occupation came to an end. And that was because they couldn't renew the treaty with the Iraqi government to make their presence legal. And so no longer does the US have this kind of influence on Iraq. It's very clear to me that the Bush administration in particular used the military to achieve something for big oil. It was a misuse of the soldiers who went there, many of them lost their lives, thousands of them lost their lives. And not only did they put American troops in Iraq in this situation of violence in order to help out big oil, they consistently made the situation worse for Iraqis. Hundreds of thousands of Iraqis lost their lives. But now that they don't have troops there, now there are no longer US troops or British troops in Iraq, no longer can they exert the kind of influence they used to exert. They simply don't have the political power to drag Iraq back in a different direction. And you know what that says to me? That says, actually, perhaps there is cause for optimism. I've seen what Iraqi civil society can do before, and actually I believe it can do it again. And I think one of the things that's going to make a difference is how much support they get internationally. A lot of the time when the trade unions and other groups have been attacked by the government, it's been when American trade unions or anti-war groups have spoken out. They've held demonstrations, they've written letters, and they've said, Iraqi government, we're watching. We know what you're doing. And that has restrained the government. And right now, a fantastic organization called US Labor Against the War, so uslaboragainstwar.org, is organizing a solidarity campaign with Iraqi trade unions to restrict these attacks from the government. And so, to conclude, I think there are three directions Iraq could go in: dictatorship, sectarian war again, or moving towards democracy. And I think it's Iraqi civil society that has the potential to bring about the third option. And not only that, but while the government tries to attack the Iraqi civil society, this is something that you and I can participate in. If we express our solidarity with Iraqi civil society, if we get involved in the campaigns, for instance, by going to uslaboragainstwar.org and signing up, we can play a role in helping Iraqis build a better future for their country. And at the end of the day, that's why I remain an optimist. I encourage you all to get involved. Anyway, you've been very kind to listen to me for so long. Thank you very much. I'd really welcome your questions and your comments.